Hi, my name is Ben Saville. I'm a senior statistical scientist at Berry Consultants, and today I'm going to talk to you about subgroup analyses in clinical trials. In clinical trials, the primary analysis is often what I would call an average treatment effect. This is where we take an average across everyone in our study population, and we conclude that the treatment is beneficial if the treatment effect is large enough. What this means is we recommend that all future patients in the study population be treated with this new therapy on the premise of this large average treatment effect that we observe. The problem with this approach is that humans are naturally heterogeneous individuals. There are a large number of differences between us with respect to demographics, our genetic profiles, our disease type, and the severity of disease that we might have. This means that patient response to therapy is also heterogeneous. We're not going to all respond to one therapy in the same way. For example, suppose we have a single antiviral drug and we want to compare it to placebo for a respiratory viral infection, and we have an outcome of days recovery. What if the treatment effect is only present in some of the patients? In other words, let's say it depends on the type of viral infection. So shown here is four different types of patients corresponding to these potentially four different types of viruses that patients may have. Now, we have a wide range of benefit that may be observed in these different types of patients. We may have no benefit in some patients. We may have a three-day benefit in other patients. We may have other patients where you actually do worse with this new therapy because there is some sort of anti-effect of this antiviral. What we typically do in clinical trials is we lump all these patients together into one population, and we calculate an average treatment effect across all these different types of patients, no matter what virus they actually have. In this particular case, if we have these numbers given here, and we have equal prevalences amongst these different subgroups, it would correspond to an average 1/2 day improvement. Now, that's not a very big effect. So if we run a trial where the true benefit is 1/2 a day, we're very unlikely to show any benefit in this patient population. And we're likely to conclude that this therapy is just not very effective. However, that isn't the truth. We know, in fact, that this therapy is beneficial in some of those patients, depending on what type of virus they actually had. So what we would really like to do is to be able to identify which of those patients actually have the benefit and distinguish them from the patients who don't have the benefit. The problem with looking at different subgroups in the study population is that we increase our chance of finding false positives just from chance alone due to multiplicities. It can also create bias in our estimates. In fact, if there are a lot of subgroups, I'm going to be very likely to find benefit in at least one subgroup just by chance. This means that I'm very likely to produce misleading results with these type of subgroup analyses. In fact, I had a graduate professor once who said that if you torture the data long enough, it will confess. And this is very true. So, with respect to multiplicities, does this mean that we are stuck with this paradigm of only estimating an average treatment effect in the population? I would argue no. But we need to make a very good plan to investigate multiple subgroups. I would like to talk about two general types of subgroup analyses. The first is what I would call post hoc subgroup analyses. These are analyses that are not planned in advance. They are rather exploratory, and they can be used as hypothesis-generating analyses to identify subgroups. The problem with these types of analyses is they are unreliable and misleading due to this multiplicity issue. The second type is what I would call pre-specified subgroup analyses. These type analyses have more credibility. They can prospectively address the multiplicity issues that are there, and they can incorporate these subgroup analyses into the primary objectives of a trial. I would like to focus the remainder of my time on the second class of subgroup analyses, these pre-specified analyses. And I would like to walk through four different strategies that I think are helpful for these type of analyses. The first are multiplicity adjustments. There's a whole range of methods out there in the literature for controlling the family-wise type 1 error. There's the Bonferroni, there are stepwise procedures such as Holm and Hochberg, and there's gatekeeping procedures where you only get to go to subsequent hypotheses and subsequent subgroups if you win the higher order hypotheses. The idea is basically that we share the alpha among the multiple hypotheses. Because we're sharing the alpha, the type 1 error, this will typically decrease the power for the primary research question. And because of that, that's an undesirable characteristic. And because of that, a lot of people, what they do, will try to avoid this penalty and limit the number of predefined subgroups in a trial. There are also a range of corresponding corrections one could make for bias that are prone to some of these same issues with multiplicity adjustments, and that they're just not done very much because of the difficulty of implementing them and the difficulty in interpreting the results. Number two, modeling interactions. Some of the common strategies that I think are rather weak strategies that I see, some of the problems. Number one, subgroup analyses are sometimes done on just subsets alone, ignoring all of the data. For example, we might just limit a particular analysis to only children or only adults and ignore all the other patients in the data. We splice and dice the data into smaller and smaller subsets. We also might dichotomize a continuous subgroup of variables, such as age, at an arbitrary cutoff. So for example, we might take age less than 65 versus age greater than 65 years old. And this makes a pretty strong assumption that a patient who is 64 years old differs from a 66-year-old, which may not be true. Some better modeling strategies that can account for both of these deficiencies identified above. Number one, we could model the interaction of the subgroup variable with the treatment. So what I mean by that is you have an analysis that includes all data, and you are modeling the differential benefit based on the subgroup factor. The other thing we can do is we can recognize that some of these continuous subgroup variables are better modeled as smooth nonlinear functions. So if we recognize that a 64-year-old is actually very close to a 66-year-old, it'd be better to fit a some sort of a spline or nonlinear function that would model that particular interaction with the treatment. Number three, Bayesian hierarchical models. These are models where we use all data to model the subgroup-specific treatment effects. The basic idea is we shrink the estimates of the different subgroups towards the overall mean. And by doing that, it becomes a compromise between complete pooling, where we're using an overall mean, and independent subgroup analyses, where we treat them all as being independent from each other. This type of strategy can reduce bias, as well as the probability of false positives. And more importantly, it can be pre-specified to address the issue of multiplicities. And by doing this, we can also evaluate the probability of false positives in a prospective manner and calibrate the model and the design to address that issue. So for example, if we return back to this example of the four different viruses all treated with the same antiviral drug, we might observe estimates of 0, negative 2, 1, and 3, which are shown here on the graph to the right with the blue lines, the blue dots and the corresponding confidence intervals. If we were to do independent analyses, these blue lines represent the analysis we would get. The Bayesian hierarchical model, what it does is it pulls those estimated means towards the overall mean. And that Bayesian hierarchical model is shown in the black dots and the black lines. And we pull the overall mean, if you recall, is 0.5. And so we're pulling the overall mean toward that 0.5. You'll also notice that the confidence intervals, the precision increases. It gets more narrow confidence interval because we have more information when we estimate each of these subgroup effects. Number four, adaptive enrichment trials. These are trials where we have some sort of adaptive algorithm where we stop accrual to one or more subgroups based on accumulating data. The idea is we enrich the study population with patients who are most likely to benefit from the particular therapy. Some key features of this type of design is we need to have prospectively defined algorithm that, number one, will define the subgroups. It will define the timing and when these interim analyses occur. It will also specify a model for estimating differential benefit in each of these subgroups, as well as rules for stopping accrual to one or more subgroups. And most importantly, we need to have a prospective plan for rejecting the null hypothesis in a given subgroup. In summary, I would like to close with what I consider to be good practices for subgroup analyses. Number one, be sure to pre-specify all your subgroups and hypotheses prior to running the trial. This will make it very transparent what your analyses and your intentions are prior to running the study. Number two, use all data in estimation and inference of the subgroups. This will avoid a lot of the issues you see with splicing and dicing the data into smaller and smaller subsets. Number three, use appropriate models, in particular the Bayesian hierarchical model for statistical inference. These models can reduce your bias and your probability of finding false positives in a way that will lead to more reliable estimates. Number four, prospectively evaluate probability of obtaining false positives. If we can quantify this number prior to running the trial, we will be able to make adjustments and calibrations to the design and to the analysis that will properly account for this. Number five, when you publish your results, be sure to report all subgroup analyses you conducted, not just those that have statistical significance. This transparency will allow the scientific community to better interpret your results. I think that with careful planning, we can do a lot better than just an average effect. We can provide effects in multiple subgroups that have scientific credibility. Thank you.